Mary Jo Bona, who's a professor of Italian American Studies and Women's and Gender Studies, and the chair of the Department of Cultural Analysis and Theory at Stony Brook University. She's past president of the Italian American Studies Association and served for 6 years on the board of MELOS, the Association of Multiethnic Literatures of the United States. A specialist in the field of multiethnic American literary and feminist studies, her authored books include Women Writing Cloth, Migratory Fictions in the American Imaginary, By the Breath of Their Mouths, Narratives of Resistance in Italian America, which is for sale in the other room, Claiming a Tradition, Italian American Women Writers, and a book of poetry, I Stop Waiting for You, which is also for sale in the other room. Hint, hint. Bona is also editor of The Voices We Carry, recent Italian American women's fiction, and she's co-editor with Irma Maini of Multiethnic Literature and Canon Debates. And she also is the series editor of Multiethnic Literature for the State University of New York. Her current project engages mother-daughter studies and its intersections with queer and cultural identities. And today she's going to be talking to us about Adria Bernardi, Object of Desire, Women's Cloth Work as Transnational Symbol and Mobility in Adria Bernardi's Open Work.
I want to thank everybody for being here. Can you hear me? Okay, good. And I want to thank Anthony for beginning these conferences in April. They're really special. It feels like a regional Italian American Studies conference, and I'm so grateful to the whole staff and Fred and everyone at Calandra for making it happen. So let me begin. Adria Bernardi's Open Work, this is the cover of her book, relocates migratory tales about ancestry within a regional context, refining and destabilizing given histories of Italian migrations, and in particular myths about Northern Italy. Italian open work functions as a fabric text with transnational implications, connecting women, work, and consciousness in more than one national territory, as Donna Gabaccia has argued. Bernardi's governing metaphor of sewing equally serves as a bulwark against the destabilization that occurs with migration and a counter-narrative to institutional forms of oppression by church and state in post-Risorgimento Italy. As part of an intertextual strategy that links communities separated by geography and century, Bernardi employs co-narration in open work to establish a communal bond between a 20th century interlocutor and a central figure of sewing, Imola, who functions as a wounded storyteller, navigating space and time differently. Disclosing larger historical narratives that have shaped the destinies of powerless women, Bernardi offers alternative documentation by reimagining memories of silenced voices. Imola Bartoli's handwork liberates lives defined by poverty and maternity. The Roman equivalent of Clothos, Nana, ninth, was originally a goddess called upon in the ninth month of pregnancy. Imola's labor as a wet nurse aligns her with village women forced to abandon illegitimate infants. Bernardi unearths the linked activities associated with traditional women's work in 19th century Italy, wet nursing and sewing, critiquing the highly organized system of infant abandonment in Italy by representing Imola's handwork as a semiotic response to a form of institutional control that, if it did not condone, then increased infanticide. In this presentation, I will focus on Bernardi's dedication to exploring multiple ramifications inhering in her fictional migrating object, specifically the traveling tablecloth, eliciting a critique of institutionalized classism on both sides of the Atlantic. I was really happy with Carol's presentation because of the open work and the connections with the handkerchiefs, et cetera. And I do want one of those, so let's talk afterwards. Okay, Bernardi opens up a view of women's, Bernardi opens with a view of women's migration shaped by the cloth worker's art, in this case, Imola's method of open work. Open work refers to ornamental or structural work as of embroidery or metal, containing numerous openings, usually set in patterns. There's an example. I argue here that by writing an ethnographic counter-narrative, Bernardi discloses and links the gendered work in 19th century Catholic Europe, wet nursing, and sewing. I further contend that Bernardi's representation of Imola's handwork increasingly serves as a response to the oppressive system of infant abandonment in Italy, forcing women to leave their babies at the foundling wheel, Catholic Italy stigmatizing illegitimacy. For Imola and her cloth-working sisters, literary and historical, artistic production ultimately functions as an analog to storytelling, which allows for both imaginary and actual voyaging. As Openwork demonstrates, Imola's work as a wet nurse and cloth worker is not subsidiary to the family's economy. Sewing bridal linens by trade, Imola teaches sewing to her daughters and neighborhood girls, who then transfer those portable skills to another country. For Italian women, both North and South, women migrated in large part because their families needed their labor to survive. Imola's remunerated work more than shores up the family during lean times. It sustains them 6 months out of the year, as they cannot rely on her seasonally migrating husband's money to arrive. To evoke ideas of connectedness across space and time, Bernardi not only frames the beginning and ending of open work with the voice of La Sarta, but also implements what Marie Laurie Ryan calls the stack, a narrative technique that models the mechanism of the crossing of boundaries. I won't read these, I promise, but you can look at them. Three separate but interconnected paragraphs appear outside the pages of open work, which might also be called a prologue, from the Greek prologos, literally meaning before speech. Applying this paratextual convention of a three-paragraph prologue permits the author to incorporate a historical documentary value into her fiction. Displaying both didactic and semiotic purposes, I suggest that this three-paragraph prologue functions as an extra diegetic before story, but simultaneously, it is inevitably touched by the fictive, the shaped, the invented. The spatial representation of the three block paragraphs in open work serves two interweaving purposes: to give the appearance of squares of cloth in deference to Imola's trade as a seamstress, and to express mobility of Italian migrants through a simulation of the picture postcard, invented during the period of the Second Great Migration, an equally provocative traveling object. Bernardi assures this connection spatially within the prologue and thematically through Imola's fascination with the postcards she collects from Africa, France, and New Mexico, the migratory destinations of her three brothers. To summon her brothers, Imola repeatedly views their postcards as a reminder of her longing for them, as a commemoration of the absent, to quote Derrida, but also, as Jelit Hassan Rokum explains, to recognize the irreversibility of the migratory move, which is thus metonymically alleviated by the counter-movement of the postcard in the opposite direction. As emigration decreases face-to-face contact, postal communication becomes a compensatory mode of storytelling. Imola's own regional migrations reiterate a family tradition of wet nursing, as both her grandmother and mother engaged as wet nurses. Thus, Imola is deeply aware of the prevalence of foundling hospitals in northern Italy and of the symbol of their institutional control, the wheel, la ruota, wooden cylindrical concave boxes, which were in a window-like aperture in the wall of the hospice and served as cradle turnstiles. Informed by her grandmother that the hospital was a death box, Imola is sensitive to the high rate of infant mortality. As Mary Jacobus explains, leaving one's children at the foundling hospital was a form of socially condoned infanticide. An entrenched social institution and a highly regulated industry, wet nursing in Italy and throughout Catholic Europe was undergirded by a thick network of informers, landlords, neighbors, employers, and various officials. Openwork illustrates this phenomenon throughout Imola's wet nursing journey. At yet another subsidiary way station during her migration down the mountain, Imola cleans the baby she is wet nursing, but also asks permission to tuck in his swaddling, a protective token from its mother, a tiny piece of red coral wrapped in a linen handkerchief with loose slip stitches. A slip stitch is also called a blind hem, since it is almost invisible on both sides, a kind of open work Roland Barthes describes as a discontinuous visibility. One imagines Imola having embroidered this handkerchief, connecting birth and milk mother to the baby without appearing to have done so. Oh, I forgot to show you the postcards. Those are some postcards from the early part of the 20th century that I found and took in when I was in southern Colorado and in the Mesa Verde region. Okay. I'm coming up to the next one. So a slip stitch, I already said that. Okay. Oh, there's an nice example. Imola is discouraged from tucking the talisman inside the baby's wrappings by a woman acting as an intermediary between wet nurse and final destination. This woman tells Imola that she does not know where the baby's last stop will be, the emphasis on secrecy and concealment exacted by officials of the industry. When Imola persists in questioning, how did they locate this baby? The intermediary responds with facts in accordance with a well-regulated business. There are networks, doctors and priests. Many babies from the mountains are sent away. The distance isn't as great as you might think. For Imola, the distance is as wide as a chasm. From her unofficial perspective as a maternal breastfeeder, Imola is parent to the children she has suckled, despite stigmatization of illegitimate children by church and state. Her compensated work never prevents her mourning the loss of children whom she nursed for a fee, for they were treated with the same devoted attention as her own. Imola's sani dolorosi, painful breasts, lament those children who are all but guaranteed to perish within a few months inside a formal governmental system. In a final rendering of her thoughts at the mental asylum, San Lazaro, Imola recalls the faces of babies from her mountain village, like her own and others, whether she nursed them or not. Their infants' faces appear like faint photographs, intaglio, but translucent, like figures stamped on tiny, holy metals. Imola's intaglio is threaded into her body, a design incised or engraved in a material. It is no wonder the first request Imola makes at the asylum is for needle and thread. An Italian Penelope, Imola believes that if she just keeps sewing, the babies will not be lost. For as dowry seamstress of her community, Imola knows that working the cloth affects a material satisfaction that signifies what has been lost to infant abandonment and migration, the children of Italy. While open work portrays traditional links between embroidery and femininity, it also examines the subversive potential of cloth work, with Imola's tablecloth serving as a testimonial to survival and resilience in the face of gender and class oppression. Refusing to exchange through commerce what she discerns is a coveted item, Imola instead sends the tablecloth to her brother's widow in the desert. As Jane Schneider clarifies, embroidered trousseaux were deemed wealth objects with significant liquidity in wide spheres of exchange. So desired an item of exchange, a lady with pearl buttons on her boots travels up the mountain to persuade Imola to sell her magnum opus, the creatured embroidered tablecloth. She refuses. This time, she will not be compelled to utilize her body to turn a profit. And like her wet nursing capability, her artist's hands become an alternative form of nourishment in place of an absence. Like the biological mothers for whom she has substituted, Imola replaces scarcity with sustenance, embodying in her artist's hands the etymological meaning of the word foster, which means to feed or nourish. As Annette B. Viner reminds us, the kind of possessions that people try to keep out of circulation is far more theoretically meaningful than assuming that exchange simply involves the reciprocity of gift giving. Open work reproduces kinship connections across continents, with the embroidered tablecloth signifying the quintessential Italian woman's communal art. Imola teaches the art of embroidery to her own daughters and village girls. To defeat loss, Imola sends her enormous tablecloth to a weeping widow, keeping her brother's memory alive through this cloth rendition of Noah's Ark, a transnational symbol of migration. Imola's iconic tablecloth encapsulates and transcends familial and national borders, embroidering differences without subjugation, creating a large tablecloth which symbolizes the enormity of the migration experience. Imola's method of open work embroidery represents the activity of sewing as a radical act, fundamentally rethreading transplanted migrants to their paese as the clothwork preserves tradition while it alerts them to an understanding of diaspora that crosses borders and opens connections between generations and places. Open work ultimately submits that milk is thicker than blood. That's saying a lot in an Italian American novel. Okay, Bernard, we can talk about that. Bernardi's portrayal of Imola as wet nurse and needle worker enables the author to draw attention to the peasant woman's historical role in nurturing generations of Italian children. A communal undertaking, clothwork transcends norms of reciprocity as women become the creators and controllers of highly valued possessions, a currency of sorts made from cloth. Imola's silent rebellion is revealed through the work of her hands. The specific needlework technique of open work can be read as Imola's textual response to the closed system of the foundling wheel and its institutions, intricate networks of social control that regulated the lives of childbearing women. Custodian of an Italian future in America, Bernardi honors the potential of clothwork to mend what seems are irreparable fissures. Beyond its utilitarian value as a source of economic support, clothwork's aesthetic value, as represented through openwork embroidery, illuminates the enduring nature of social ties. This particular piece of openwork was sent to me by Adria Bernardi, and it was her great aunt's from sort of the area of Modena. In the 1920s, circa 1920s. So I was thrilled to get this particular piece to put into the book.
Embroidering with my grandmother and my mother, the three of us sitting there, and my father would paint designs, he's an artist, for my grandmother. She would embroider them. And then she invented them, she kind of directed him, he painted them. So the three of us would sit there and embroider, and I later learned that many Italian women always brought with them their embroidery hoop.
Right.
And yes, that was like a really treasured possession. Is this so? I don't have any evidence of that.
I can tell you that my grandmother did all forms of sewing and all kinds of special embroidery work. And she transferred those skills on to my eldest sister, but not to me. I think she had realized that it was a hopeless case, that I would eventually just have to write about it. And so in homage to my grandmother and my sister Carmen, I dedicated this book because they are such skilled artistic women. And I felt like I really lost out on something.
It's interesting to me that, Mary Jo, that you're talking about the degree of infant death and infant mortality in the 19th century. I guess I'm curious as to what Italian historians make of that, or did you come across any...
I did a tremendous amount of research before I tried to make any kind of claim.
Yeah.
I mean, I went well beyond Kurtzer's work on it. I looked at Fuchs. I looked at many, and I looked widely, not just at the situation of infant abandonment in Italy, but throughout France, in Ireland, and comparative analyses in Western Europe with those countries that were primarily Catholic versus those that were not. And certainly the experience of infant abandonment existed in all of them, but by far had a much longer extension of time in Catholic Europe.
And when did the rates of infant mortality decline? It's at the beginning of the 20th century?
The foundling wheels were closed, if I should, you know, that form of institution that existed for hundreds of years. Probably by the 1920s, we're seeing almost the end of that. But interestingly enough, I came across recent articles about Italy asking for the ruota to be opened again, so that babies who are found near garbage dumps or something have some place to go. So there's been a recent sort of resurgence of interest in that system in Italy.
The other thing is that even as late as the 50s, little children, 3, 4, and 5 years old, were "quote unquote" sold to foreigners.
Yes, thank you. Very interesting. I just want to say that I understand perfectly this whole tradition of needlework, not because I did it, but because my mother and my older sister did it. They were actually, when they came in the 50s and the 60s, they brought quite a bit of that with them.
Do you have any, Peter?
I actually do in my house, a couple of them. Oh. But my older brothers and sisters obviously got most of it and then it's been now passed down to their daughters and sons who cherish them very well. Although the art of producing them has disappeared, whatever is left has become very precious in my own family and in a lot of families from those years.
Oh, that's wonderful. It's great to hear.
It was really, really unbelievable. I didn't even know the names, but my sister used to know them all. She used to explain it to me when I was a kid, but I didn't understand any of it.
I just had to figure they must have had enormously good eyesight at one time.
They did.
Be able to sustain doing it.
I think it's pretty interesting. I've read several novels set in China where Chinese women, of course, abandon their children regularly when they're girls.
I think that's really interesting.
And often wrapped in a piece of homespun material from the original village. I can share one of the books with you.
Let me share with you then. Toward the end of the book, the interlocutor American narrator ends up adopting two Chinese babies.
Amazing.
The research that Adria Bernardi did for this book was amazing. She's also a translator, so I was thinking of you, Amelia. It was amazing. It was so intricately done, this like a beautiful piece of open work embroidery.
I for one, owning many of my great-grandmother's pieces and passing them on 5 generations later, am very grateful that you are the writer that is keeping a lot of this alive.
Well, and may I add that Bia Mori's work at Ellis Island, her installation exhibit at Ellis Island with that beautiful piece of open work with the large pieces of iron work on top of it, is the cover of my most recent book. And I am thankful to be, as artists, for being so generous with your images. And you had the right DPI the whole time. I didn't have to ask you to do anything more.
My grandmother taught sewing in Italy, and I brought some photographs of her work if you'd like to see them.
I would love to see them.
But what hits me is that these clothwork skills translated into a real advantage in joining an organized workforce.
Yes, like a guild.
Like a guild or even in the needle trade unions.
Absolutely.
And, my grandmother's sister worked in a large powder puff factory here in New York City. And so from cloth work made for the home and the dowry, that gets translated here into socialized labor.
Right, exactly. And there's a nice book on that issue, the way in which some of the smaller factories managed to employ Italian women, I can't remember the name, Angela, maybe you know, but it maintained that sort of connection with Italy. It may have been Miriam Cohen, that's one of the books, but it's important, that linkage. They weren't in factories just like doing shirt waists.
the fantastic thing about this is also how it goes across the globe. And I may have mentioned that already to you. When we talked about this, for instance, an Australian artist at present who's second, third generation, Lucy Calipari Marcuzzo, who's now in contact with the Calandra and who's working on the idea of the trousseau and recreating her mother's trousseau and what was in there, what would have been in there if she'd been richer, but she couldn't afford.
Exactly.
So again, this whole issue of class and also of labor is there. But the question is, you talked about, you know, milk is stronger than blood. And what about language in this? You were saying, you in a sense, you substituted your ability likewise here.
Right.
You know, it was a desperate case in my case.
Exactly.
Your ability or inability to stitch with the ability to stitch words together.
Right.
How does Bernardi work with the idea of language and with the migration of language in that book?
It's interesting. In the novel, she actually has dialect Italian from northern Italy, and Anne has learned to translate herself, even though she's an American writer of an Italian American background. But her people were from the Modena region of Italy. So the language is part of the loss as well, and the grieving that takes place by the time you get into third and later generations. Part of the loss is the language, the dialect not being respected, right? Being ashamed to use it wherever you are. And then for Bernardi's people who grew up in the Chicago area, I think it was called Highland Park, and that was the sort of working class neighborhood that was flanked between the two rich, like really ritzy suburbs. It was an ongoing loss throughout the generations. So the language of loss is stitched into Bernardi's open work simultaneously with all the other things that she's doing concurrently. Thank you.
Great. Let me just add one comment or one question, and then we'll have to close. But that is, in Italian, the word is immolare with two M's, but in Latin it's with one M. And seeing how Adria is bilingual and is a translator, and I just wonder how much that name Imola, and she has all these weird names like Antenore and Egidio and so on and so forth. So it really goes back, and I'm wondering how much she's playing with names
Everything I ended up looking up had five different meetings, and it went all the way back. Yeah. So she was, and in fact, she's so aware that her reader's going to mispronounce the Italian names that she says she incorporates the right pronunciation somewhere or another in the text.
Great. Thank you.